الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly and we ask Allah to exalt the mention and grant peace and send His salutations and His blessings upon the Prophet Muhammad. Who is God? I dare to say this is the most unique question in the world. It is the most unique question in the world. Now, what makes something unique? Can anyone define unique? That's a lot of answers. Take it easy on me. Huh? What?
Nothing like it.
Nothing like it? Okay, I like that. Say if you had something, say if the linguist, you had something to say, huh?
Something special.
Something special? Yaatik al-afiyah, Saif. Something special, okay. Unique is when something is unlike the rest. If you have a unique cover for your phone, it's supposed to be a cover that no one else has. Unique skills, unique individuality, so many things can be unique. They're supposed to stand out. Now, of course, if you travel enough, you will come across someone who has the same unique skill. But to a large degree, that remains to be unique. And this question is very strange because it is the most complex and sophisticated question in the world, and yet it is the simplest question in the world. It's what they call paradoxical. It's a paradox. It's the opinions or the definitions conflict and oppose each other. How can it be the most complicated and yet the simplest question in the world? It is the most important question, more important than all the questions you've ever had to answer in your life. It is the most important question for this worldly life and the most important question for the life to come. It is unique because it is the only question that only God can answer. Yet, it is the only question that every human being should be able to answer. How can this be in one question? Of course, we're not referring to the title of the lecture. So you will not think, oh wow, that was a great title. It's the actual concept behind this question. It is unique because you have to be very careful when you address it. And you cannot speak from your own intuition, from your own ideas, from your own preferences, from your own choices, experiences. It's a question that requires revelation, preserved revelation from the one whom we're speaking about. It is the most unique question in the world. And it is sad to say that the vast majority of human beings are unable to answer that very simple question. And I am referring to mankind in general, irrespective of religion. And Muslims are included in this. So to be flat out, my target audience today is Muslims and our guests from among other religions. Because this is not something that we want to explain to people who don't know Islam and leave the Muslims oblivious. Say, let them figure it out on their own. The fact that we have accepted an aspect of Islam does not guarantee salvation. Because salvation is based on the understanding of this question and then having an answer. The first question in the grave is what? Mar Rabbuk. Who is your Lord? Who is God? And if you haven't studied this matter, if you haven't understood it, according to the prophetic tradition, one of us will say, he will not be able to answer. Even though they might have academically studied this subject matter, took a course, and they have a certificate from some online university on the names and attributes of God. That is insufficient because it is not an academic discussion. It's a matter of belief and implementation. Knowing things is good. In fact, it could be very bad. Acting upon what is good is salvation. Putting it into practice, living up to its standards, sharing it with the people, with our deficiencies, with our shortcomings, with our human incapabilities. We will never ever be able to fully fulfill the rights that that question has. But it does not mean that we don't make attempts. So while I could actually address this topic from like 1 million perspectives, I think it's endless if we wanted to use an approach, a single approach or method to explain it, it would be suitable for some and not suitable for others. So it's a very difficult mission trying to explain to a wide audience of people from different backgrounds, different nationalities, different mindsets, different philosophies, different ideologies, different choices in life, trying to explain their creator to them. But I seek Allah's aid and assistance in simplifying this matter and allowing me to adequately present it to you so we all leave this hall with a common understanding about who God is. Now, what we do about that afterwards is a personal issue that no one can get involved in. What we do about it is our own choice. I will try to highlight some of the, while we could go into a lot of discussions about who God is in different religions, I don't think that would be the wisest approach right now. I would rather focus on who God is from the Islamic perspective. And then people of other religion can use this information to make their own comparison. What you understand of God versus what I'm going to present from an Islamic perspective, not my view as a speaker, but what our revelation had shared with mankind. You make your own comparison, and with the inner sincerity, you can judge which one do you prefer to be the proper definition of God. The first principle that must be laid out, nevertheless, is the common misconception about God. If we were to put Islam on one side of the scale and the rest of the religions on the other side of the scale, we will see that the main fundamental difference between them, generally speaking, is that in Islam, we do not have an image of God, nor do we believe that He manifests in any of His creation, and we don't have an image of Him that we can even visualize or imagine. It's not open. That door is not open for someone to sit back and say, let me think, what could God be like? Because if we were to do so, each one of us will have his own idea and his own image, and that is impossible. While with other religions, to a large degree, exceptions do exist in case someone belongs to that exception, you will find that somehow, some way, God has become part of His creation or manifests in His creation, or the human beings find the urge to create an embodiment of this God in some idol, in some statue, in some drawing, somewhere along the line. The examples that come to mind are many. Or the human beings who have elevated regular human beings into the level of God. Whether those individuals acknowledged and approved of that, like Fir'aun. Pharaoh, as we Muslims believe, was an example of someone who established himself as a God. And he ordained that he is worshipped as such, he had people worshipping him. As Allah says in the Quran, he said to the people, أنا ربكم الأعلى. I am your Lord, the Most High. He probably said that right after he came out of the bathroom. God was in the bathroom. Do you think about that? You have to think about that. Because if some dude came along the line and told me, I am God, I mean, I'm going to put him to the test. On the spot. I would require information from the past, present, and future. I would ask him to create something. Right now. If he's unable to create something right now, it's done. You failed the test. And Allah said that in the Quran when speaking about idols. وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ. And they have, mankind, have made for themselves, they have taken for themselves gods. Allah called them gods because in their mind, in the minds of the people, they are gods. Now listen to this amazing description. لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا. When we trash talk, when we trash talk when playing sports, the objective is to make the person feel completely useless. So what do you say to someone? Man, you got nothing. Right? It's not like you praise some skills, you need to, but you can't shoot. No, no, you got nothing. And that's like, whoa. No, I got something. Even if that something is nothing, he will still feel offended by you got nothing, meaning you're done. And this is just to bring the idea closer. And Allah's speech is beyond that. لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا. They create nothing. Nothing. وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ. Rather, they are themselves created. Any God besides the one true God, who I will elaborate on throughout the lecture, any other God was created by us. If it's an idol, we sculptured it. And I've said this before, and I will never ever forget this video, wherein a statue of Mother Mary. You know Mother Mary? How do you Muslims feel about her? Excuse me? Do we love her? Do we cherish her? Do we honor her, respect her? For sure. Is there any other woman in the Quran that has a chapter named after her? Nope. Nope. Only Mary. She's a high figure in Islam. In fact, among the greatest women ever is Mary, the mother of Jesus. This is where she is in Islam. This is the status she holds. But in a church, they had made her into a statue. And people like your respectful selves were present for whatever worship they were about to engage in. And some older men, they should have brought younger ones, were carrying the statue on their shoulders. And the front row was all nuns. And the people of high, you know, the figure, high figures among the Christendom, in the Christendom world. And one of the old men tripped. And the statue fell over. And it broke. And the people were in complete shock. Screaming. You should see this video. It's on YouTube. And when you watch this, you can't help but reflect. Whatever worship you were about to dedicate to this object, even if you claim that this is not the actual Mary, but it's just a manifestation of her, so it should have some equivalent virtue. It should, otherwise you're adding to Mary what she didn't approve of. Either you say, we know this has nothing to do with Mary, so we say, then what are you doing? What are you doing that she didn't tell you to do? Or you say, no, because this is an idol, a statue of Mary, it shares some of her qualities. And she's the mother of God, quote unquote, from a Christian perspective, so she deserves worship. So then how is it that this idol fell and broke and the people's worship was terminated? Until they made a new one. So we look at this and say, this is a sign from God. There are many other examples that highlight that these idols that human beings have revered and respected and gave such status, all of them are man-made. They require your maintenance, you have to clean it. If a bird were to drop some gifts on it, it cannot prevent it. There was another video that is even wilder than that. When among some people of some religion who, you know, worship the cow, and that was in the UK. Sorry, Sheikh Bahtasim, not trying to speak on about your country without any authorization. But anyways, this cow turned out to have a disease. I think it was the mad cow disease back then, right? And the government set and issued a command that it has to be killed, because this thing is going to harm other cows and what have you. And the police came to confiscate or to arrest, I guess, the cow. And the worshippers were in huge, they were crying, there was a hue amongst them, they were all freaking out, panicking, that their God is about to be taken away. So they were trying to finish off the last kind of prayer they can perform before it's all said and done. And sure enough, they came and took the cow. And you would think if this cow had some sort of divine quality, the first thing it should have said is, back off. I'm a cow god. You're not taking me anywhere. And it would throw something at them and all of them would fall and die. Then we will start to think, okay, wait a second, man, we need to investigate this cow further. But see, none of these things ever happened. So a cow that is reliant and dependent upon you, O son of Adam, to train it and move it around and benefit from it and milk it and what have you, then, of course, if you're a beef eater, eat it as a burger. That's what a burger is at the end of the day, a cow. A beef burger, that is. So we say these are signs. Signs for mankind that are evident before our eyes. And that's why Allah said in the Quran, لا يخلقون شيئا وهم يخلقون ولا يملكون لأنفسهم ضرا ولا نفعا. These idols and gods, whatever you want to call them, intercessors, they further do not possess for themselves any harm or any benefit. They can have no control of things. So if something is not in control, how can it offer you any control? Can a drowning person save another drowning person? How would it happen? You throw him above the water, then, you know, he falls right before you drown, he throws you above the water, and you keep just bouncing like some fish until a boat comes and saves you? No, Habibi. When two people who don't know how to swim are drowning, they're going to go down together. According to studies, even your best friend, you will use him as a log. Just ride on the dude. Put him under your foot as long as you stay on the surface. What happened to the friendship? Forget about friendship now, man. It's life or death. I'll find another friend tomorrow if I survive. That's how selfish you are, by the way, huh? No, some people are heroes, right? Some people are heroes. They wind up, you know, putting their life at stake first to save a friend. Yeah, when you meet someone like that, introduce him to me, please, because I need someone like this in my life. Everybody else seems to run away. So they have no benefit. They have no harm or benefit to themselves. How in the world are they going to help you? وَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ مَوْتًا وَلَا حَيَاةً وَلَا نُشُورًا. Nor do they control death or life or resurrection. This is the definition of an ungod in the words of God. So anytime someone calls you to any type of object of worship, you must use this criteria to identify whether it is worthy or not worthy of worship. And until now, no God passed the test. Because we would say to this God, you control, this is your idol, you believe this is special, whatever that is, it could be a human being. I want him to kill this person now. And there's a dead man over there, bring him to life. Do it. Mind you, this is not Jesus doing, you know, miracles in the name of God, which we believe in. That's a prophet. Prophets were doing miracles, but as the Quran said, بِإِذْنِ أُحْيِي الْمَوْتَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. This is why the Quran is so technical. Even when it narrated the story of Jesus, every time Jesus was mentioning his miracles, he would say, I do this by the will of Allah. I give life to the dead by the will of Allah. I heal the leper by the will of Allah. It wasn't some independent task. Or tell this thing to create a mosquito. You bring any idol, any statue, any object of worship, that I want one mosquito. What is smaller than a mosquito? I don't know. What's the smallest insect? Lice? No, I don't want a lice, bro. Because you know my hair. Take a long time to get rid of it. Just shower. Lice, whatever you want. Lice, ant, mosquito. Just make one tiny one for us right here. Oh, dear God. And make me happy. Oh, you can't do it. Oh, okay. You failed the test. These are all the definitions of the non-gods. But if you look at the vast majority of people, their object of worship falls somewhere in that category. Either man-made or distorted from previous religions. Meaning, the Christians were never told to believe that. No way on earth Jesus would violate the first commandment or the second commandment. Who knows the second commandment? Is there a Christian here? No Christians here? No Christians. One Christian. Do you know the second commandment? It's okay if you don't. Most don't. I'm not mad at you. The second commandment is that you should not make an image of God. There should be no image, drawing, sculpturing, any type of idol, statue that resembles God. That's the second commandment. So how in the world then did we manage, or did they manage, to have all these idols and statues and images of God when the second commandment says there shouldn't be any image of God? Go back to the first commandment, then there should be only one God. The Lord, our God, the Lord is one. How can it become three in one, or Father, Son, or anything else that is complex? So Jesus would never preach that. So either there are religions that had been given the pure monotheism, but with the passage of time, it was distorted, or religions that are completely based on idolatry and paganism. And we have many of those, fire worshippers, people that worship everything. People can worship anything and everything. It's amazing. And they give all this to those who are not deserving of any of it. Because the one who's deserving of it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the exalted. Why do we say Allah? We have to say who is God, because languages are sometimes confusing. You cannot really say Allah is the Arabic equivalent of the term God. For so many reasons, and I'm not going to bore you to death with that discussion. It's an old discussion. But the bottom line is, when Muslims speak about the Creator, we speak as per the revelation we have. And yesterday, Sheikh Mu'tasim explained the virtue of the Quran in Arabic and why it is preferred in so many ways to be the language of revelation. Right? And some may say, well, how come it cannot be in English? Well, if the Quran was to be in English, then what about those who speak Spanish? Then if it were to be in Spanish, then what about those who speak French? So they couldn't be one universal language for all of mankind. At the end of the day, there isn't. Maybe English now is the most popular. It was not back then. Therefore, it is inevitable that there will be one language, and then it's upon mankind to translate, explain, and share. That's just how we do with everything. Are you going to tell me every book of medicine or engineering was written in the, you know, in Malay or whatever the language here is? No. A lot of them are a translation from some, maybe Arabic as well. It's just the way things happen. We translate stuff. So then we have to refer to the Quran, and the Quran called God Allah. Interestingly enough, in the Hebrew language, which is a sister language of the Arabic language, and you find among many of these dialects, the terms are actually close. Eli or things of the sort, you know, Elohim. Again, you see the dam and ha, the H and the L are there in the word, in the root word. In English, they use the term God, but then because of the complexity of the English in this regard, you have capital G and lowercase g, a small g, to differentiate between the true God and some other type of God. I believe the Quran is the most effective tool to answer the question, who is God? Specifically through an incident that happened between a prophet and his respective people. A prophet and his respective people. Who do you think we can cite here? There are many options. I know the Muslims should be able to give me a good 10 answers. But who do you recommend would be the ideal prophet to mention in trying to explain to mankind who Allah is, who God is, based on an event that happened between a prophet and his respective people? Who said Ibrahim? Were you looking at my notes earlier? Did anyone else think of Ibrahim? Can I see your hands? Interesting. Who thought of Musa? Bardo halu. Good stuff. And this is why the Quran is an amazing book. It has stories. And usually stories tend to be, unless you really like reading, boring. Only people that are obsessed with reading enjoy reading. For most people, reading is like the most annoying task in the world. You can deny in front of your friends, I don't care. There are people that enjoy reading, and you sometimes see them on the airplane or in the airport. You're playing games on your phone, and you see some dude with a big old book. And you're like, dude, like really? It's a 7-hour flight? And this guy reads the book the whole time. Doesn't even sleep. And in your mind, this is insane. Wallah, you wouldn't read a book if they put you in first class. Say, I stay in economy, man. I'm not reading no book on a plane. But that person, if you were to give him 10 gadgets from your gadgets and say, hey, play with one of those. Oh, no, thank you so much. I'm happy, man. I'm reading a book. So we admit that people are different. All those who don't like reading books feel guilty now. Wow, what a man. So, if you don't like reading books, again, that's a disclaimer. You don't want to read a story and then, you know, you have comprehension, right? You have to answer the questions and look for something. Yeah, and people who don't like literature, they hate this subject. I personally like it. I don't read that much, but I used to enjoy reading a story and then have to answer the questions that are not directly stated there. You have to kind of understand from the context and the whole story. I found that interesting. Some people don't. It doesn't matter. The bottom line is the Quran has so many stories about the prophets. But see, if it was merely a story for you just to pick up some information or make some deductions or summary of it, then it would lose its effectiveness somewhere down the line. But never is this the case. You can hear Surah Yusuf, and I recommend for every non-Muslim who has never read the Quran. If you've never read the Quran, never picked up the Quran, and you wanted to read something, I personally recommend chapter Joseph, the prophet Joseph, Yusuf in Arabic. Go through it and live. Go through the story. We hear it every Ramadan. In every Ramadan, if you go to some masjid where they recite the whole Quran, you hear it again from beginning to end. And every time, it's a different story. It's the same story. But every time, your relation to the story is different, depending on your stage in life, your age, your circumstance, your situation. Whatever you're going through, you will relate to something. If you're in love with some girl, you know what I mean? And the option is there for you. The temptation is there. And you have an open door. Then you hear Yusuf when his master, the lady master, was chasing after him and throwing herself on him. You know, inviting him to adultery. In his case, it would be fornication. And he ran away from her. And he said, "Oh Allah, prison, if I'm put in prison, is more beloved to me than doing this." Then you feel, alrighty then, I'm going to calm down. If you didn't hear that, the shaitan might be taking you somewhere. And then once you come across it, you say, not anymore. Even though you heard this so many times, but there was no girl in your life, you didn't relate to this incident. You might have related to Yaqub, his father, Jacob, who was crying over the loss of his son. And you had lost a family member. But he was patient. And he was patient for the sake of Allah. And he made expressions that signify his acceptance of the decree of Allah. Wallahu al-musta'anu ala ma fasabrun jameel. Beautiful patience. So you relate to patience. So it's an amazing dynamic relationship with the book of Allah. And so even though there are so many stories of the prophets, there's something, there's a secret in each one. And Ibrahim is Ibrahim. And if your name is Ibrahim, don't feel that special right now. He's like, yeah, that's right. I'm Ibrahim and I'm proud of it. But Ibrahim set so many examples because his people, his father was the actual businessman who made idols. So you have a prophet who's been chosen by Allah to be the one who communicates the message of monotheism and the abandonment of idolatry and what have you to the people. And his own father is the main source of idolatry in his town, among his people. That's pretty tough. That's like a politician having a particular view and his own son is the opponent going against his own father's views. Can you imagine what it's like at the house? One is a Democrat, one is a Republican, for example. I don't know. I can't think of better examples. It's just something that is really at odds. It's just, I mean, you gonna go against me? I'm your father. Yeah, but I disagree with your views. It makes it very difficult. That was Ibrahim's situation. So Allah tells us, and I'm going to read the Arabic because I believe the Arabic has an impact. Sometimes we omit the Arabic part because of time restraint. But this is the main topic, so I'm going to give it its due right, inshallah. And I don't have the beautiful voice to give you this amazing recitation, so I'm not going to try to make you deaf by hearing me. Because, you know, the good news that when I was a rapper, your voice didn't matter. It's not like, you know, 50 Cent sounds like Celine Dion or something. I mean, the dude sounds like a dog barking the whole time. But the son of a gun can put some, you know, words that rhyme with each other. And hey, he became rich. And he's still worth 50 cents. I'm so sorry, 50. I didn't mean to do you like that. What a choice of words. What a name. At least I was called Spitfire. You know, I was supposed to be spitting fire. I never burnt anyone, but still. 50 cents, $1 million maybe. Anyways, so I will read the Arabic and then give you the English equivalent with the regular, no recitation, just formal reading. But anyways, Allah says in the story, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ Ibrahim. Narrate unto them, this is now Allah commanding our Prophet Muhammad, may Allah exalt his mention, to tell everybody during his time, knowing that this will reach the last person before the Day of Judgment. This is not only for the Arabs then. Because he also told us, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Convey of me what you hear, even if it's one verse. If you've only received one verse, convey this one verse. That's your job, my job, everybody's job. So he knew already, based on the knowledge Allah gave him, that this message will be preserved, as Allah promised him, and it will be maintained. So it will be delivered to mankind for many generations to come. Therefore, the command, narrate unto them the story of Ibrahim. How did it begin? إِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ وَقَوْمِهِ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. When he said to his father and his people, what do you worship? What are you worshiping? Of course, it all started at the time of Noah. At the time of Noah, there was no polytheism. There was no idolatry. Everybody was worshiping only one God. Then Satan, who believes in Satan? We all believe in Satan. Huh? Satan and his children among the devils, their job is to divert you from this path. That's just their work. This is their main role in life. And sadly, they don't have any vacation. They don't take a lunch break. They don't take any time out. Excuse my language. The bastards are working 24/7 to make sure that you and I go off track and wind up in the hellfire with them. So it's a very tricky thing. Nobody's going to give you a break. They will not give us a break. So at that time, some righteous people, very good people that were devout worshippers of Allah, passed away. And when good people pass away, you know, you feel sad. That causes the society to grieve and what have you. And you have many choices. Nowadays, of course, the habits of the people, children of Adam, have changed. Now they have, you know, they put it on Facebook, right? That someone died or something. But they didn't have Facebook back then. And they didn't have cameras. Samsung, iPhones, LGs, none of that stuff, or whatever, Canon, all that good stuff. They didn't have that option to take a picture. And when someone dies, you know, you would like to see that person. So you can reminisce on the old days. Not necessarily. We believe that from an Islamic perspective, it is good that we shouldn't have that option. Because the last thing you want to do is feel sad over again. Why relive the sadness? If someone's parent passed away, if you don't have a picture of them, then at least it's whenever they come to mind, whenever they come to your mind. Of course, you have images of them in your mind. You may feel some sadness. But if you have a picture of them next to your bed, then how many times would you like to relive this moment of grief while you're alive, causing you depression when you're not supposed to be depressed? You're supposed to move on. That's why God made us forgetful. It's mercy from God that we're forgetful. If someone's father or mother passed away and you couldn't forget, you can never live afterwards. If this was the only thing on your mind, you can't study, you can't get married, you can't function at a job. You're just sad. But what happens? We forget. When we remember, we feel sad. When we forget, we move on. And you know, in the early stages, you remember a lot. At some point, you completely forget. It becomes like a random thing every now and then you remember your parents. We say this is mercy from God. Because if you didn't remember, you would struggle a lot. So what Satan suggested back then, look, these people passed away. You would like to keep their memory alive, don't you? Don't you want to remember those good worshippers of God? So why don't you make statues in their resemblance? So that whenever you're worshiping God and you feel demotivated, you feel lazy, you don't have the same level of spirituality, you look at these idols. They don't mean the idols. The idea behind it was the persons they resembled. You remember those individuals and that will push you, you know, to become better. I guess if I were to give you the boxing example or one of these, you know, sports, then, you know, if somebody liked, what was his name? Muhammad Ali. I guess if he was, you know, fighting with your friend, then you look at his picture and he looks all mad, like, yeah. So you take from this energy from this picture and you knock out your opponent, or what usually happens, he knocks you out. So that picture didn't really benefit you, did it? But anyways, people like to think that picture helped them in some way. So, I mean, we do these things. So that was the idea of Satan with the people. And sure enough, that was the intention. That's exactly what happened. It went as per the plan. That those human beings were using these idols just to remember how good they were, and so they would worship Allah with the same level of sincerity and devotion. But then that generation passed away, and other generations came, and at some point in time, the people now looked at these idols with a completely different perspective. They said, these are so good, we are so bad, how are we going to communicate with God directly? Those individuals are more qualified to represent us before God. We will use them as intercessors only. We know they didn't create the heavens and the earth. We know they didn't create us, but they are qualified intercessors. So we will use them. Now this sounds logical. Who thinks this sounds logical? We're evil. These are good. So now they can communicate to God. Let me give you another example. You're a lousy employee, and you have a direct manager who's on excellent terms with the head of department, and the head of department hates your guts. If you wanted a vacation, do you go to the HOD directly, or is it wiser to go through your manager and have him sort it out for you? Huh? We say the logical thing is don't go direct, man. Let him handle. Why? Because he will discuss so many different tasks. And among them, he will be, by the way, this guy, he wants a vacation. I don't want to hear a lot of stories from him. Just approve it. So the guy will do him a favor and he hooks you up. I feel like I'm describing someone's real life. And they're like, yeah, that's exactly how it happened. Yes. I hope you're not that guy, man, or that girl. Anyways, that is perfect and logical, but that's exactly what polytheism is. When you treat God like human beings. Let's look at the other example. You have a boss, an HOD, head of department, who told you, listen, you're a nice guy, I like you. If you need anything, my office door is open, you walk right in, you ask me, I promise you I will give it to you. Does that sound good so far? Reasonable? You feel good, huh? You wish this will happen in real life. It's not going to happen, by the way. But let's just assume that this is the case. And you have a manager, the direct manager, who's a punk. He doesn't like you, and he's not willing to hook you up. In fact, he's an obstacle between you and the HOD. And you needed a vacation. Who in his right mind would go to his direct manager and say, can you please speak to the HOD for me and ask him if I can take a one-day vacation? How would you feel about that genius? Would that be the wise thing to do? If he were to do it, and then the HOD, what do you think his reaction is going to be afterwards? He's going to come and say, are you mine, man? I told you my door is open. Anything you want, I will give you. After I gave you this direct access, you insist on adding someone else? You know what? Not only you're not going on vacation, you're fired. And I think all of us would endorse that. I would stamp that paper where he fired him. Fire him, man. This guy is insane. And I would tell you, this is exactly how human beings deal with Allah. He told us, you have direct access. He says in the Quran, ادعوني استجب لكم. Call on me, I will respond to you. I am your Lord, I am your master. And don't go through anyone else. And then human beings insist on finding some dude, somewhere, some object to make them their connection with Allah. And to Allah, this is the greatest crime ever. Because you're abandoning that special connection he gave you, and you're trying to reach out to him through an intermediary that he did not establish. It's insulting. Just like that HOD will feel insulted, because he's gonna think, what's wrong with me? I mean, I told him I'm ready, I told him I like him, I told him my door is open. What in the world is wrong with this guy? Where did I go wrong? And in the case of Allah, that could never be the case, because Allah would never go wrong. That just shows you how guilty the son of Adam can be in this regard. So they were taking these idols as intercessors. This carried on until the time of Ibrahim. That was the norm. فَإِنَّهُمْ no, I'm sorry, yeah. قَالُوا نَعْبُدُ أَصْنَامًا فَنَظَلُّ لَهَا عَاكِفِينَ What are you worshipping? He said to his father and his people, what are you worshipping? They said, we worship idols and remain to them devoted. قَالَ هَلْ يَسْمَعُونَكُمْ إِذْ تَدْعُونَ Do they hear you when you supplicate? That's an interesting question. For anyone who's worshipped anything but the one true God, do you have any solid proof and evidence that they heard you? أَوْ يَنْفَعُونَكُمْ أَوْ يَضُرُّونَ Or do they benefit you or harm you? Do you have evidence that they are the ones in charge of whatever benefit came to you or whatever harm afflicted you? You can't prove that it was from him, from that idol. This is now the unified, universal, standardized answer of every human being from the time of Adam until the end of time. And we hear this until today and we will never stop hearing this. قَالُوا إِنَّا وَجَدْنَا آبَاءَنَا كَذَلِكَ يَفْعَلُونَ We have found our forefathers doing that. And every person now who belongs to a family of some religion, 95% of the time, it wasn't through investigation. It was because this is what my parents were doing, this is what I'm doing. So if a Christian is born into Catholicism, and you ask him why you were Catholic, not born again, it will be by default because my parents were Catholics. Now you find some Christians who when they study on their own, they leave Catholicism. They see it to be another, you know, form of idolatry and they choose to be Protestants or born again, which is a milder type of, you know, not getting into the idolatry of God. There's still some issues, but at least it's not as severe. There are no temples and idols and what have you in the church. And the rest of mankind is the same thing. Why do you do this? That's how my parents did it. So we copy our parents in almost everything, except in what is good. Most of us go against our parents in the good things. Father's a nice guy, son is a drug dealer. Father is a respected person, son is a gangster in the street. They're like, this is your father? Dang, what happened to you, man? Life. That's life. I don't know. You wanna rebel. You wanna be rebellious. Or the father is an alcoholic and the son is a very nice person, very kind person, very gentle. Or the lady, of course. I'm just using son as an example. No sexism intended here for the feminists. Hell, they'll pick on that one. Why you always use men as an example? Maybe because I'm a man. How did I get here? Anyone remembers? Yeah, so we follow our fathers and mothers and generally, you know, the good things we leave alone. But in religion, most people will conform to whatever the family has. Very few will venture on their own and say, you know what, I'm nice, mama, I'm glad that you're, you know, Hindu or you're a Buddhist, but allow me, I think I'm mature enough to do my own investigation and then decide at some point to leave them and go on your own. It happens, but it is not the most common thing. That remains to be a unique thing that happens to some people. So they said the same thing, look man, don't get too funny with us and philosophical. Our forefathers were doing this, we're doing the same thing, just chill out. Or as they say today, chillax, which is supposed to be a combination of chill out and relax. That's for the lazy people, by the way. The people who smoke a lot of weed, by the way, at some point even words become burdensome. So you just kind of put four or five words in one word and khalas, you should understand based on this one word everything I want to say. You know what I mean? Just trying to be brief, just be brief. Sometimes it's just a nod. 18 things are said in this nod, you know, khalas. You got it? Yes, I got it. You rolled it, I rolled it, everything, we're ready. The whole setup is just with one wink, one head move. Why waste time, man, talking too much? Leave this for the lecturers who come to the Islamic Society every year. Such as myself. Now, so Ibrahim wasn't having it. You know, this is a nice reason. It's a nice justification, but it doesn't fly, really. It doesn't fly. So Ibrahim was, in this context, he was very blunt, I would say. And sometimes this is the manner in which you invite to Allah. When we share the message of Islam, there are different methods. There are times when you are subtle, times when you are gentle, times when you are direct, sometimes you're indirect, and sometimes you just have to be in your face. You know what? I've beaten around the bush too much, and I think if I don't just tell you flat out what it is, you will never understand it. I don't want to be responsible for not communicating the message effectively, so I'll tell it as it is, and you figure it out on your own. Just my disclaimer, don't get upset. I don't mean to offend you, even though you may be offended in the process. You know, you grow your hair. I'm using that example. You grow your hair. You love growing your hair. And to you, it looks so cool. And then your friends use it. Dude, what's up? Man, that looks ugly on you. I mean, how do you feel? You're just torn. You know, like, you love your hair. You spend hours fixing it. And the guy showed no mercy to your style and preference. But, you know, did they mean to offend you? Probably. Or it could be that they're just being honest with you. Look, man, we're so close, I'm not going to beat around the bush. I just don't like your hair. I liked you without hair more, for example. So even though you may be offended in the process, no offense was intended. And anytime we discuss religion, you're about to be offended. There's no way around it. Because we're challenging your views, your belief, your concepts. So there's confrontation. And when it comes to this topic, that will happen, but don't get offended. Ibrahim used that style in that context. Listen to this. Does anyone know the continuation? Does anyone know these ayat of among those who memorize the Quran? Tafaddal ya Sheikh. By the way, I'm sorry. I'm citing the middle of the Quran right now. Somewhere in the middle of the Quran. And Mawlana over here will be able to continue the ayat from memory. I haven't memorized, alhamdulillah, but I'm reading from my... I'm not going to advertise it. Yet, he will cite it from memory. And it will be exactly identical, I believe. Hope, don't make mistakes. To what I'm reading, including the diacritical signs, which is the small vowels. Meaning, he cannot say a, u, or e, except that it's in agreement with what I have in front of me. I put him on the spot so bad right now, he wishes the earth would open up, swallow him, close up, and nothing happened. I'm so sorry, brother. But that's what happened when you say you know the rest. Would you like to read? Uh-huh. Qala afara'aytum.
Qala afara'aytum ma kuntum ta'budun.
Continue.
Antum wa aba'ukum
ta'budun. Continue.
Fa'innahum a'duni.
Illa rabbal alameen. Jazakallah khair. That's a miracle for you right there, live in Nottingham University. Put this on camera. Oh, it is on camera. Now listen to this, Ibrahim alayhi salam. He said, okay, then do you see what you have been worshipping? You see these idols of yours that you've been worshipping? You and your ancient forefathers? He's now reaching out to the forefathers. Then he said it flat out. فَإِنَّهُمْ عَدُوٌ لِي. All of these are my enemies. I'm not playing games when it comes to who is God. I'm not sugarcoating when it comes to who is God. That's the method of the Prophet. All of these are an enemy to me. But he had to make an exception. إِلَّا رَبَّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Except the Lord of all things. Because there's only one Lord, one God, for sure. For sure. This is not coincidental. All of these idols are my enemies. That does not mean violence. Disclaimer for the non-Muslims who don't understand Islam. This does not mean that in our mind, you're my enemy, I'm going to blow you up tomorrow. Wait, all these idols in the church are our enemies, we're going to kill you. No, no, no. The fact that you oppose an ideology does not necessitate physical action. People who go to that degree are violating the teachings of Islam. Don't ask a Muslim to be happy and satisfied with other than Allah being worshipped. We cannot. It's offensive that other than Allah is being worshipped when He is the only one who deserves worship. But that does not mean that I have the right to transgress or oppress or violate other people in the name of my belief. It's something that I discuss with you in an intellectual, verbal manner. It is not some fist fight or some violent act. So even though, sadly, we have many Muslims killing non-Muslims in the name of this principle, I'm telling you, by Allah, it is not from our religion in the way it is done. So he told them, all of them are my enemies except the Lord of the worlds. Okay, so now the question is, the most important question, and this is the answer to the lecture. Is it still not there? What happened, man? I like that thing behind me. You guys are bluffing me by all this projector. Big old projector looks like an airplane, and it can't even show the flyer. Who do we blame? Safe? You're not that safe after all. Anyways, maybe the projector's down. So now the question is, who is God? Even for the people, you want to define God in the simple terms. And this is why I said in the beginning, it's a very complex question, yet it's a very simple question. And the answer is very simple as well. The first explanation he gave, which you and I can relate to, is الَّذِي خَلَقَنِي فَهُوَ يَهْدِينَ. The one who created me, therefore he guides me. And that, and you know, presents another question. You say, the one who created me. So now you talk to yourself. Don't talk to me, talk to yourself. Who created you? Everyone has to answer that question right now. Who created you? Either you created yourself. If so, please stand right there. Because I would like you to create another person who's your twin. Has anyone created himself or herself here? No? Okay, who created you? Who believes they came from some random event that had to do with the collision of some galaxies and molecules with energy and gravity and the whole shebang? And the Big Bang? That was my rapper background. And then all of a sudden, here you are. You know, male, female, with the way we're created and the compatibility. You know what I'm saying? Like, really? What are the chances? And then somehow, some way, then we can reproduce and bring other people like us? I mean, it's mind-blowing for even someone to start thinking that we came this way. It must have been God who created you. Who is God? That's the question. You can't answer that unless He tells you. If He didn't tell us, we would be in big trouble right now, all of us. Because then each one will have to invent his own way. Well, wait, let me think. What could it be? Who could He be? But He did not leave us unattended. He in fact sent so many scriptures, so many revelations, through so many human beings, throughout time, until the Prophet Muhammad, being the last. Ensuring, because he is the last, that his message remains preserved throughout the years, and here I am making it happen. This is crazy. So that no one can come to God and say, well, I don't know what was going on. I didn't know who you were. No, he told you who he was. You didn't care. Don't blame anybody but yourself. It's like the school announces everywhere that there's no, you know, no classes tomorrow. And it's on the billboards, it's on the flyers, it's on the TV. And you're walking around oblivious. And then you come to school, you're the only student on campus. And you're like, what happened? What's going on with the school? This is ridiculous. I just drove 45 minutes. Dude, it was all over the place. We told you, but you didn't listen. You can only blame yourself. You can't blame the principal and the students and everybody else. What else can they do if they put all the signs for you and you decided to wear your such cool sunglasses that you couldn't see Jack? Because some people, you know, the sunglasses look so cool, right? They try them out. Say, man, I can't see nothing. But I look cool. It's all right. And then they wear them in the airport. And I'm always amazed that someone sitting in the airport is absolutely no sun. He's sitting there with the sunglasses. Those are the ones who usually want to check out all the ladies without anyone knowing what's up. Right? So they now they have free, right to check out anybody. It's just wild. Then you cannot blame anybody else if you did not want to communicate with this message that has been presented to you very, very effectively. And the Quran, of course, is a manifestation of all that, because not only the Prophet Muhammad's message was permanent and eternal, the scripture which supports it has been preserved, unlike any other scripture before. That is a living miracle again. How can we not see that? How can we ignore it based on, well, I was born in that country and Islam is not prevalent. I'm not an Arab. I'm not an Indian. I'm not Pakistani. Therefore, this religion cannot possibly be mine because of such and such. No way. This is not an answer to God. Because He did not make these restrictions a justification for you to reject. The message is universal. It has reached you somehow. Even if it's reaching you right now for the first time, there you have it. It has reached you. And it's upon you now to do something about it. So then, we know that God created us. And therefore, He will guide us. No one else. Guidance is not in the hands of people. It's in the hands of God. That's what we've said many times. No matter how well Islam is presented, if you don't ask your Creator to guide you, no one can do the job on your behalf. It's not about how eloquent the lecture is. It's about how well you and sincerely you ask your God, Allah, to guide you. Many people are too arrogant to do that. Within themselves, they don't want to feel that they are in need of a greater power. If you were so self-sufficient, then there are so many things that you could do on your own, but you depend on others. So if you're depending on your parents to, you know, give you a place to live, and on your boss to pay you the, you know, your salary, and on the professor to educate you, you're depending on all these elements. You're depending on others to build a bathroom for you to use it. You don't build your own bathroom every time you go to the bathroom. You've depended on all of these entities, and now when it comes to God, you suddenly have an issue? Why? When He has given you all of those other things that are being used for your service. It's not your boss who gives you the money. It's Allah, God, who gives you the money through this guy. If he goes away, another one will come along. If Allah has this money decreed not to reach you, no one can bring it to you. It's just a matter of you believing in that. Further, وَالَّذِي هُوَ يُطْعِمُنِي وَيَسْقِينَ. This is again very simple. Ibrahim is telling them about simple facts. Who provides me with food and drink? Is it these idols that you worship in? Do they just pull out food from nowhere? Who grows out the vegetation? It's not that, you know, God just, you sends a plate and you just have lunch, say, you know, this is what God gave me. Who allowed the earth to function where there's the sun, you know, upon the grass and the whole process of vegetation growing for us to reap that and eat it? This whole process, which is very complex, you study it in science, in biology, in physics, in chemistry, because it's so mind-blowing. Who allowed it to happen consistently in this orchestrated manner? It's Allah, not these idols, not these other gods. It's the one true God who created the universe and manages it in this manner. So simple stuff. He feeds me, He gives me the drink that I have. وَإِذَا مَرِضْتُ فَهُوَ يَشْفِينَ. This is an amazing ayah. It's one of the miracles of the Quran and the one that teaches us the manners of the prophets. He said, and when I become sick, He grants me the cure. But let's be honest. Who made you sick to begin with? Who? Allah? Didn't we say everything is from Allah? Does that include sickness, poverty, calamity? For sure, they're all from Allah. But because Ibrahim would not want to ascribe that to the Creator out of respect, even though it's a fact, then he said, when I become sick because of my issue, He's the one who grants me the cure and removes the illness. So referring the grace to Allah and the illness to himself. While he knew, like we all know, that it's all from Allah. As a test. You get sick from Allah as a test. Because we human beings become forgetful and heedless. You don't even communicate with God. You're just in your own world. Until something happens to you, then suddenly you become like a little mouse. You know, and suddenly you now are mindful of God. And you start asking for things. Help me, I'm sick. I this, I that. I have an exam. I need to pass. You were not asking for anything until something happened to you. So this is how God reminds us of our dependence upon Him. And there's no shame in that. There's no humiliation in that. This is actually an honor for the son of Adam. So these things happen. Sickness cleanses us from our sins. We learn from Islam. The Prophet said, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, you see the thorn? If a thorn pokes your finger, how much pain? Let's just say a needle. You go to the doctor, they give you a shot. That pain that you feel, Allah will alleviate or will expiate sins equivalent to that amount of pain. Let alone when you have a greater sickness, greater calamity than an equal amount of sins, then we are all sinful. We need that stuff. So our sickness, our illness, our poverty is also mercy from Allah. And the opposite of that is a mercy from Allah. It all has to do with how we react to it. وَالَّذِي يُمِيتُنِي ثُمَّ يُحِينَ That's another fundamental principle. It is He who will cause me to die, and He who will bring me back to life. Who is the one who claims the souls? Ultimately, Allah. How many people have you seen those who came to near-death situations where you could swear that person should have died, but they didn't die? I've seen this. Remember I told you about the car compilations, right? The accidents where, you know, these road accidents and people just out of the... There are people who out of the blue died and people who were supposed to die who didn't. And I watch both and I'm just mesmerized. You know, some person walking down the street and then two cars crashed into each other and they both went like this, and the person is in between, standing against the wall like this. And one car went like this, the other one right next to him. And he is safe and sound. And of course, everybody in the car is dead. It's a major accident. Another one, some person is walking, minding their business at the intersection, you know, in the pedestrian lane. And then some car all the way there crashed into another car coming this way. It hit him, that car flipped like four times, landed on the guy, killed him. See, subhanallah. You know what's up? One of them is not meant to die now. One of them is meant to die. This is, who controls that? Can anyone say, I'm going to control that when it happens to me? If an accident happens, I will make sure I'm the guy in the car who will not die. Or when an airplane crashes and all the passengers die except one. Can you say you will be this one? I mean, no one knows. No one has control over that. This is all in the hands of Allah. But further, we will be resurrected again. That's very important, because if there were no resurrection, no accountability, then it's all in vain. All this is in vain. This lecture is in vain. Your education is in vain. Your whole life is in vain. What's the purpose? Just live, reproduce, eat, drink, go to the bathroom, and then what? Oh, then nothing. That was a big waste of time. I aspire for more than this. I'm sorry. Human beings are beyond that. That's how animals don't mind. Animals just do anything, anytime they want. Some of them have more manners than we do. You know, cats at least clean after themselves when they use the bathroom. And some people go just leave a bomb in the bathroom and walk out and say, well, who cares? I don't care if you die from this and you look at this nasty thing. I couldn't even flush the toilet. Some people don't even flush the toilet. I don't know why I'm discussing this right now, but because it happens so often, it really bothers me. And then every time I see an unflushed toilet, I think of the cat. See, what a cute cat. It just cleaned after itself, and when it sees you, it freaks out. You know, they're just such nice people. But then when they reproduce, they do it right in the street. So it's like, the cat, you're a hypocrite. One time you're trying to be nice with the bathroom, but then, you know, come on now. Choose a lifestyle and stick to it, because this is too much for us to handle. Yeah, anyways. So والذي يميتني ثم يحيين. Ouch. It's okay. I apologize. I've gone overboard. Anyways. Now this is very, I would say spiritual and sensitive, because you know it shows you the tranquility and the softness of the heart of Ibrahim. I mean, Ibrahim is a leader. He's an example. He's someone who devoted his whole life for Allah's sake, you know? And his book of records is something we can only dream about. Can't even imagine what's in it. And then how does he conclude among the things he says? وَالَّذِي أَطْمَعُ أَن يَغْفِرَ لِي خَطِيئَتِي يَوْمَ الدِّينِ. After all this, and who is Allah? The one whom I hope will forgive my sin on the day of resurrection. Ibrahim. So what do you say? What do I say? Because see, no matter how good you are, it's all in the hands of Allah. That's why it's important to have this relationship with Him while we are alive. At the end of the day, sins are destructive, either sooner or later. And Ibrahim was asking that he doesn't want to be held accountable for his sins. What are his sins? Can we even count them? Can they even exceed 5 or 10? Probably not. Yet, he wants Allah to forgive him on the day of judgment. Do we human beings feel this way towards our Lord? No. Many of us come with a load of stuff and they couldn't care less about that moment, about that accountability, about that responsibility. They just don't care. They are fighting against their Lord by disobeying Him, using this very means He gave them. The same body parts, the same limbs, the same money, the same tools, from God against God. Children of Adam. Anyways, he continued to make dua, and the story, of course, is very, it's a very emotional story. But the bottom line is, and because of time restraint, I don't want to really give you the whole thing. But it goes on to explain the condition of the people in the life to come. And then it tells us about the debate which will take place between the inhabitants of the paradise and the inhabitants of hell. Because after it's all said and done, these are the only two destinations for people. For animals, believe it or not, they are more fortunate in this regard. Because as Allah says in the Quran, you know, وَيَقُولُ الْكَافِرُ يَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ تُرَابًا. Huh? When at the last day, animals, even animals, will get their rights from each other. So the cat, which was chasing other cats and beating them down, on the day of judgment, the beaten cat will get its right from the one which beat it. That's the justice of Allah, even among animals. However, afterwards, they will all be turned into dust and then disintegrate. There's no heaven or hell. For us, it's one of these two destinations. There's nothing in between. You can't go to a third destination. You can't say, listen, this is too much, and I think I've, you know, messed up in my life, and I just want to, let's just go back, okay? Send me back and I'll fix it. Nope. How about, I don't care about what's next, you know? I don't want anything. I'm cool. I don't want neither hell nor for heaven. You can keep paradise for yourself. I'm cool. I don't want anything. No. You want a way out? No. So it's one of these two. Yes. Which? Huh? It depends on the question which we are discussing today. Really? Simple terms. It depends on whether throughout the years you've lived, you cared about the one who's allowing you to function right now. You've given him his due right. Instead of take, 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 nothing back. And what we give back to God is not to make him any better. He already has the beautiful names and ultimate attributes. It's for our own well-being. It's for our own good. For our own spirituality and purity in our hearts. So they will have this discussion. Obviously, they will, the people will start blaming others. It's not because of us. Had it not been for these people who misled us from the path of Allah, and everyone will start blaming others. People that belong to different sects within religions, they will blame the leader of the sects. People will blame their governments, and those people will blame those idols, and some will blame their parents and the society and their neighbors, and everyone will have someone to blame. But none of them will be accepted, because you had been given the faculties and the means to make your own decisions in life, to judge on your own, to evaluate, to assess, and to move on. Don't blame others. No one has, and if someone imposed something on you and forced it upon you, they can do it physically, they cannot do it to your belief. Can someone squeeze your arm to believe something? If I brought another person, say, hey, I want you to hate this brother. Hate him right now. So I don't hate him. I'll punch you. I'll break your neck. I'll break your arm. No matter what I do, I don't do any of that stuff, by the way. That was just an example. Do you think I can make you hate this person no matter how bad I beat you? No, this is something that is in your heart. I mean, you can't force me. You can beat me enough to beat him. And even if I punched him just so you can stop punching me, I still love him. Bottom line is, the matters of the heart, no human being has control over. So you cannot blame anyone else because of this, because of that. Even if they had a gun to your head, said, believe in this or disbelieve in that, you can't control. You can't control what's in the heart. So no one can come and give that excuse on the day of judgment. Now, I wanted to just quickly, and I will end the lecture with this, share with you some of the names of Allah which appear in the Quran and the prophetic traditions. Because many don't understand who we're talking about. And I think this is crucial for us to not to be, you know, vague. I don't like vagueness. I want to be straight to the point. So let us be straight to the point. So when we describe Allah, who are we referring to? Because of course we don't have an image. We haven't seen Him. No one has seen God. No one has felt God. No one has experienced God in a sense, something tangible, right? You experience His guidance and His love and so on and so forth. But you can't experience anything tangible. We have to know who He is. Not according to what my grandfather said, according to what the Quran and the Prophet Muhammad taught. So Allah Azza wa Jal is Al-Ahad. Al-Ahad means the one who is unique in His oneness. Because it's not really enough, special enough for you to be one. There could be many ones. But a unique one is what makes you special. So Allah is Al-Ahad, which is different than Wahid. Allah is Al-A'la, the Most High. Allah is the Akram, Al-Akram, the Most Generous. Allah is Al-Awwal, the First. Al-Akhir, the Last. He's the First, the Last. There's nothing after Allah Azza wa Jal. Everyone will perish. Allah is Al-Zahir, the uppermost one. And Allah is Al-Batin, the innermost one. Allah is Al-Bari, He's the originator who made us all from nothing. Everything in the heavens and the earth didn't have an example before. He brought it into existence. Allah Azza wa Jal is Al-Bar, the most kind. Allah is Al-Basir, the all-seeing. You and I have limitations in what we see. Once I put this in front of me, I don't see anything afterwards. But Allah sees everything, everywhere, simultaneously. So no one can hide. No matter what we do, we cannot hide. Allah is As-Sami', the all-hearing. Allah is At-Tawwab, the one who loves to accept the repentance of His creatures. Allah loves to accept our repentance. When we ask for forgiveness and we want to change our ways and go back to Him, He loves it. Not that He is arrogant, says, you know, no, He loves. And there are many narrations from the Prophet that express that type of love. How much of love, how much love is involved? The highest type of love ever when you return to Him. And that applies to the Muslims and the non-Muslims. Allah is Al-Hafidh, the protector. And He is Al-Hasib, the reckoner. He is Al-Hafidh, the guardian. He is Al-Haq, the true one. Al-Mubin, the clear and manifest one. He is Al-Hakim, the all-wise. Al-Halim, the forbearing. Allah is Al-Hamid, the one who deserves to be praised. Al-Hayy, the ever-living. Al-Qayyum, the self-sustaining. He does not depend on anyone. He doesn't depend on anyone, but everything depends on Him. Allah is Al-Khaliq, the creator and maker of everything. Ar-Ra'uf, the compassionate and kind. Ar-Rahman, the extremely merciful. Ar-Rahim, the bestower of mercy. Ar-Razzaq, the provider. How much has God spent on us from the beginning of time until now? Can you imagine? I mean, when you take out your friends for dinner, how much do you pay? I guess nobody takes out anyone for dinner. He's like, I don't know, I've never taken anyone for dinner. Why in the world would I waste my money like that? No, man, when you go out, eat your own pizza, I don't know, 15 ringgits? Try to take out 10 people. That's automatically 150 ringgits. That's a big leap in cost. Now, if you do this a couple of times a week, you'll be broke by the end of the month, and you'll be begging for some money from someone else. That's why most people don't take others out. But this is nothing, right? Now, can you imagine how much Allah has provided mankind, animals, the fish in the sea, the whales, the sharks, everything you can imagine, on daily basis, continuously, consistently, throughout time? How much has he spent? It's amazing. Allah is As-Salam, the flawless one. As-Sami', we mentioned that, the all-hearing. As-Shakur, the appreciative. Allah is As-Shaheed, the witness. As-Samad, the absolute, the perfect. Al-Alim, the all-knower. Al-Aziz, the almighty. Al-Azim, the tremendous one. Al-Afu, the one who pardons again and again. Allah is the exalted. Al-Ghaffar, the all-forgiving. Al-Ghani, the self-sufficient, the rich, the most rich and independent. Al-Qahir, the invincible subduer. We have to also know that Allah has the powerful attributes, not only those of love and mercy and compassion, but there are ones of might and strength and power. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a God. They couldn't be a soft God. They couldn't be a soft God. He has to have all the ultimate names and attributes. And again, I want to speak or give a quick disclaimer about, you know, love. Because many people confuse love. Is God all loving? Does God love everyone? If God loved everyone, this and that. How do we identify the quality of love within God? Is the love of God, is it conditional or unconditional? Who believe the love of God is unconditional? Meaning you will get it no matter what you do. Raise your hands. Whoa. Who believes the love of God is conditional? Wow. You needed this lecture very bad. Okay, I'm going to ask those who said that the love of God is unconditional a question. Those who said that the love of God is unconditional, do you also believe in the hellfire? Raise your hand. Alrighty then. Do you believe that some people will be in the hellfire eternally? So how in the world is Allah going to place someone whom He loves unconditionally in the hellfire forever? How is that? Do you know what forever means? We have never experienced forever. We experience things ending. The semester ends, the job ends, you know. Everything comes to an end. Forever, we don't know forever. Even love, which you thought was forever, didn't turn out to be so much forever, huh? It was such a temporary thing. Then you found a new love, which was supposed to be forever, but that didn't work out either. Anyways, you just realize that, you know what, forget about this. This is a bunch of bluffing. I'll just love you as long as it takes, and then I'm not even going to use the word forever anymore because it doesn't fly. Otherwise, you would have loved 1,000 people forever, but they're not in your life anymore. So it's a bunch of lying. People like to be nice and everything. I don't like that stuff. No forever in love. Except Romeo and Juliet. But then again, that's a story, right? Anywho, so how do you explain this hellfire eternally forever for the ones who God loved unconditionally? It's impossible. Ladies and gentlemen, it's impossible. Love of God is conditional. Surely He loves those who have done something about it. Now there is an element of love in the fact that we are His creation and He provides and sustains, surely. But that is not the type of love that will earn you a ticket to paradise. That's the type of love we're referring to. Otherwise, of course there's some love. But if that love is not going to be sufficient to admit me to paradise, then that's not really love. You know, like your parents, they might love you so much, but then they say, you know what, you're great and everything, but you need to move out. But mom, I can't afford my own place. Yeah, I know, honey, get out of my house. It's like, dang. I thought my mother loved me unconditionally. Yeah, until you started eating half of the fridge, buddy. And when you were a little kid, you know, she managed. Now you're a big guy, they go grocery shopping. One day later, it's gone. You bring your friends, everybody's going to eat. Your mom is going to kick you out. And if somebody asks you, do you love him? Of course I love him. He's my sweetheart. But khalas, it's too much already. He can live on his own. When does the love become unconditional? Your mother loves you unconditionally. You walk into the house. Hey, mom, what's up? Bam, punch her in the face. You love me, mom? Of course, honey. Let's watch TV together. When does that happen? Where are these parents? They don't exist, man. You punch your father once and the love is gone, baby. Somebody asked him, hey, how is Joseph? Who's Joseph? Your son. I don't have no son named Joseph. This guy punched me the other day. You're gone out of his life. Obsolete. You don't exist. Okay, I'll use Ahmed in case somebody got offended. Joseph, I don't mean just, from the Western world. Any type of name, your father will disown you. Okay, how many parents have disowned their children because they married someone that their parents didn't think was good enough? People disown their children. I know you not anymore. And khalas, it's over. So there's no such thing, really. This unconditional love is another bluff. At some point, there's, hey. You punch your mom, then this love is going to be questionable now. If you really love me, how can you punch me? And no matter how much I love you, I can't take that. And this is a human example with the parents who are supposed to be the most intimate. And the same applies to your wife. You could love your wife and everything. You cheat on her and you better believe that this love is at stake now. She's not going to believe that you love her anymore. You can explain all you want, nice. But if you truly loved her, you wouldn't have done it. So, I'm sorry, this whole unconditional love is something else. There isn't such thing as unconditional love. You earn the love of God, you become worthy of paradise. Otherwise, there's enough love for you to survive, but not enough love for you to be entered into paradise. And that is a real love, that He permits you to paradise. He admits you to paradise. He allows you to enjoy eternity in paradise. So when we say Allah is Al-Wadud, the All-Loving, we have to qualify the statement. Otherwise, we'll be fooling the people, telling them something about Allah that is not true. The Christians have that belief that God loves everyone. And every time I've questioned a Christian to elaborate further, we reach a dead end. Said, God loves you. I get this all the time because I propagate to Islam. Some people leave me a message on YouTube or something or on Facebook. You know, God loves you. They're referring to Jesus. I'm like, really, when did he tell you that? I would like to see that text message you received. Or can you explain to me the revelation, the moment the revelation came to you where someone spoke in here said, hey, go to Abu Mus'ab Wajdi Akkari, this is his website by the way, and tell him that I love him. No, please, I would like to know further, how in the world did you know that God loves me? Well, they say, no, you're getting too technical. No, I'm not getting too technical, I really want to know. You don't have the right to tell someone God loves you unless you're communicating with God on a daily basis and we don't know. So, hey, prophet, how's it going? You must be a prophet then, talking to God all the time. Telling people he loves you or he doesn't love you. Let me see. Wait. Ah, no way. No. Out, next. Shoo ya, Sheikh, ta'al ina. Where are we living, Habibi? Then passing this judgment, whom he loves. People talk about God like they're talking about some guy down the street. This is unacceptable. So we don't tell people God loves and God doesn't love. There's a criteria. Allah tells us in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الصَّابِرِينَ. He loves those who excel in goodness, those who are patient, those who pardon the people. He told us the qualities of those whom he loves. So we try to acquire them. And he told us whom he hates. He hates. He doesn't like certain things, so we avoid them. There you go. Now we can say we have a plan, we have a map, we know what to do, so we try to acquire the love of Allah to the best of our ability. But that's the obligation of every human being. The good news is, it's not mission impossible. It's not like climbing up a very steep hill or mountain. It is simply accepting and submitting. It's that relationship where you submit to the greater one who created everything. It's part of the process. It's nothing new. You're not inventing anything new. You're not going against the norm. You're not doing anything outlandish. It's very normal. So there are obligations that you have to do towards him and obligations towards his creation. When you maintain both, you're on the track. Some things you have to do, some things you have to leave alone. Whatever you have to leave alone is for your own good. It's a challenge. Surely not everything is going to, we are not in paradise. At the end of the day, we're not in paradise. It's never going to be like that. So you like to get drunk, and you like to get high, and you like to fornicate, and you like to, you know, you like so many things we like to do, but we cannot do. Because if we were to do them, then that doesn't make us worthy of entering paradise, where it's for those who have achieved and earned and strove to get there. We're doing everything that we like to do. So it is inevitable there are some challenges, things that you like, but you're going to have to restrain yourself. Now, I personally like to throw the eraser at the teacher as soon as he walks into class. And I like to clown him as well. I mean, I like to clown, make fun. Hey, teacher, what are you wearing today? We used to have a physics teacher that would wear his shirt inside out. It always blew my mind. Like, how could it be? You don't know what you're doing. I wake up in the morning. This is physics, man. You're teaching me physics. His shirt is inside out. And we just sit there. I mean, I'm like, I like physics, but not anymore. Because this is not working, buddy. I mean, come on, you're a teacher, for God's sake. You're coming here to represent knowledge and education. Can't even put on your shirt. So I would have liked to make fun of him. But would that make me pass the class? For sure not. So you have to keep your mouth shut. You know, these are comments I kept to myself. So, you know, there are so many things we like to do, but doing them is going to destroy you. You just don't do them. It's logic. It's common sense. And we follow the same trend. Anyways, in conclusion, who is God? He is your Lord and my Lord. He hears you right now. He knows what you're going through right now. He sees you right now. He understands you more than anyone else. See, right now you're sitting here, you're in your own private world that no one can enter, no one can access. It's all, you know, coded information, encrypted to you. To Allah, it's all out there, known and understood. So no matter how much we try to zigzag our ways and pretend and say this and say that, it's not going to happen. It's not going to work. He knows it already. So we should stop fooling ourselves and realize, because of His greatness and majesty, He deserves more than what I am offering. Each one of us has his level of shortcoming. He deserves more. Let's go that extra mile. If you haven't given Him any time, start to give Him time. If you've been doing some, then go that extra step. Each one of us, depending on his level, and we all need a lot of progress. But that is the objective of the lecture, not just to present some information, to help us all aspire to become better, better human beings with our Creator. If that weren't the case, then as I said the other day, then let us all create our own world. If you don't like the system, you still object to the system is not cool for you. You don't like this accountability and, you know, this is lawful, this is unlawful, this is good, bad, evil. You don't like that. You have the right if you want to have that right. If you don't like the process, I'll tell you, create your own world and do it your way. You cannot do it, then deal with it. Deal with the present and make the best out of it. So I conclude the lecture with that, and I guess we're open for the usually the very loaded questions that we receive after the lecture. Jazakumullah khair.